Welcome to the Black Excellence Tour with the amazing advocates CeCe McDonald and Joshua Allen. Despite this extremely difficult day, we are so honored that CeCe and Joshua are here to share the love with us and have brought Black Excellence Tour to the Bay Area tonight. The Black Excellence Tour has been traveling the country, and after last night, I think I can think of a few states that need this talk. Black Excellence Tour is a collaborative social justice project created by CeCe McDonald and Joshua Allen that uses art, activism, and awareness. The goal of the series is to combat issues of systemic oppression faced by trans, gender, nonconforming, and queer people of color. There's so much more work to be done, but we are so proud of the amazing work happening in the Bay Area for trans and queer people. We could not have this program tonight without community sponsors and partners in the Bay Area. Special thanks to the Trans Employment Program at the San Francisco LGBT Center for organizing this talk tonight.
Yeah.
We also would like to appreciate our partners who share in this work every day. Black Lives Matter.
Yeah.
The Trans Thigh Program at API Wellness Center. The National Center for Lesbian Rights, Transgender Law Center, everyone's getting tired. there's a couple more. So the TGI Justice Project, Transgender and Intersex Justice Project.
Yeah.
The St. James Infirmary, the Shiro's Project, and the San Francisco Trans Film Festival, and many, many more. Also, we'd like to extend a special thank you to our amazing host at the Faithful Fools for opening this space to us and the amazing work that they do for the community here in the Tenderloin and beyond. We'd also like to welcome Sam from Faithful Fools to share a few words.
There we go. I get a few more words here. For those of you who are not familiar with the Faithful Fools, we are a live-work nonprofit here in the community. Carmen and I live here, and we live here with the specific purpose of opening our doors to all kinds of people, because we believe that when people come together as creative, intelligent, energetic people and build community together, we are far stronger and far better, and we have a lot of hope. And especially on a day like today, we need to sink our feet into that reality more than most any day. So we do a lot of different things. We have art programs where people create poetry together or visual arts together. We have wellness programs where people do Tai Chi and meditation and yoga. We have a once a month movie series that brings together people from all over the Tenderloin, whether they live in the streets or the SROs or apartments, and they watch interesting movies together, and then we have a great discussion about it. So if you're a film buff, keep your eye out for our once a month film series. We have also, and some of our neighbors are really engaged with this, is the Tenderloin Votes Project, where yesterday we toured around the neighborhood with life-size puppets. We called them big heads because, well, they were big, and we got the vote out. And even though the rest of the country may not have heard our cry for justice in our votes, we did here in the Tenderloin. So we are proud to be part of a growing and vibrant community in which people have learned to respect each other, to work out their conflicts, and to be connected. And you are now all part of our Faithful Fools community. So welcome, and I'm glad to have you here. One other quick thing for you is, after we see the trailer and have a chance to listen to Josh and CeCe, we'll have some food downstairs, and you are all welcome to hang out and chat for a little bit. And I encourage you to get to know one person that you may not have known when you were walking in, because that is how our community grows and extends. So welcome to Faithful Fools, and I think it's now up to you to send us into this evening with great energy.
Thank you. So as we as we all know, 2016 has been one of the most visible years for trans awareness throughout the country and internationally as well. Although also it has been the deadliest year with over 25 trans and gender nonconforming people murdered already this year domestically in the United States, with the majority of the violence targeting trans women of color. On November 20th, we will gather to remember our fall, although we need to do more to end the violence against trans, queer, and people of color communities. This is why tonight, the Black Excellence Tour is so important. So after we mourn and dust ourselves off, let's remember who we are fighting for and who we represent when we're fighting. So we're fighting with the elders who have fought before us, like Miss Major, Sylvia Rivera, Marsha P. Johnson. We're fighting and being reinvigorated by the fights before us, such as Stonewall and the Compton Cafeteria riots. And also the movement, several movements that are happening, including Black Lives Matter and Black Trans Lives Matter. CeCe McDonald is the star of the recently released feature-length documentary about her life and her story, entitled Free CeCe. The film is amazing, and we are so excited it will be premiering tomorrow at the San Francisco Trans Film Festival. And it'll be debuting at the Roxy, which is on 16th in Valencia, at 7 p.m. Let's watch the trailer now.
We are about to fly to Minneapolis, Minnesota, and tomorrow I get to interview CeCe McDonald. I'm really emotional about this project that we're about to embark on. I've been wanting to meet and talk to CeCe McDonald for over a year and a half. CeCe is just someone I've thought about really every day that I've showed up on set to film Orange is the New Black.
This is an emergency.
Yeah, well, we don't see it that way.
I thought about CeCe and so many women like her.
I'd like to report an emergency.
Trans women who are serving in men's prisons all across the country. CeCe's case, to me, encapsulates so many of the harsh injustices that trans women of color face in this country. CeCe was just walking down the street with a group of her friends minding her own business.
Something about that day just was like not sitting right with me.
She was met with harassment.
I just started hearing faggots and you niggers and this and that. And I'm like, oh my gosh, please, let's just please go.
And this story touches me so much because I have been CeCe. I have been walking down the street just minding my own business.
People were like driving in the street, like hopping out of their cars and stuff and like challenging us.
And so often when trans women are attacked in these situations, they don't survive.
I just feel the blood all over my face and I look down, I see blood all over my clothes, I see blood all over my hands. I just remember like looking up and seeing Dean and him having this like the most evilest just, it was just so scary. And I'm walking backwards. I never once stopped. He's like, angry man, like, jogging towards me. And I'm like, oh my gosh.
But CeCe did survive. And her gift for survival is a prison sentence. When she was just defending herself.
47-year-old Jean Schmitz was stabbed during a fight shortly after midnight. Police say a group of people were fighting in the 2900 block of 27th Avenue South. When officers arrived, they found a man lying on the street with a stab wound. He died at the scene. And it sounds like maybe they've made an arrest already.
Yeah, they have arrested 23-year-old Krishan McDonald. He now faces murder charges.
They demonized me in a sense of words. They kind of just made it seem like I was on the rampage. I was just attacking people. Nobody was really trying to stand up for us. People were basically lying for these people, you know what I'm saying? Like, we were, you know, the angry black people who were, you know, looking to cause trouble.
And CeCe was arrested on the spot and not allowed a self-defense claim by the district attorney. Black bodies, whether they're trans or not, are assumed to be criminal. I got a letter from CeCe in the mail. And that day I got a letter from CeCe, Elon Nettles was pronounced dead in New York City. And Elon Nettles, 5 days earlier, had been beaten into a coma in Harlem just for walking down the street like CeCe was, and like so many trans women just walk down the street as themselves. The letter I got from CeCe, she congratulated me on Orange is the New Black. And she talked about her desires to want to act when she was younger. And there was so much hope in that letter. And I thought, why me? Why do I get to be the one living my dreams when so many of my sisters don't? So this is a big deal for me. I can't wait to meet CeCe and give her a big hug and hear from her what she wants to say to the world about who she is and about her story.
Final boarding call for passenger Gares and passenger Cox.
CeCe McDonald is an activist, speaker, and icon in the LGBTQ community, rising to international recognition after surviving a white supremacist and transphobic attack. CeCe has graced stages across the country where she uses storytelling to articulate the personal and political implications of being both Black and trans. She fosters important conversations around mass incarceration, sexuality, and violence. Joshua Allen is an organizer and abolitionist whose work revolves around issues of race, gender, and policing. Their work of coordinating direct actions, movement building, and analyzing the intersections of race and gender have been featured in nearly every major news outlet in the United States. Joshua is heralded as leading the cutting edge of new racial and gender justice movements for a freer society. As a result, they have been invited to organize, speak, and workshop in countries across the world. Please give a very special Bay Area welcome to Joshua Allen and CeCe McDonald.
Hello, everybody. Oh, that was dry. Hi, everybody. How's everybody doing? That's good. So we would like to first off thank everybody for showing out tonight. I know that a lot of you are devastated, but you know, for me, I just feel like oppression has been in existence for a minute. So don't think that because somebody is taking this position that this haven't already have been in existence. And for some of us, it's something that we, you know, see on a day-to-day basis. So like, let's shake off that negative energy of thinking that things are over and our lives are going to be obliterated, because for a lot of us that has already been happening. And you know, just acknowledging that, you know, we do have to fight harder and be more diligent about the way that we are doing this movement and being a part of it. So that's also important too.
So hi everyone. Thank y'all all so much for being out, like CeCe said. And also, I wanted to give a special thank you to all the people that helped organize this today. That labor is so important. People like organizing and resisting and finding a way to uplift the stories of people who normally don't have voices is a super important part of how we organize around the injustice in the world around us. So I wanted to just share my special thanks to everyone who put in that work today, and everyone who, just for being here, right? Being a part of this conversation is a super important part of trying to kind of change that narrative. So thank you all so much again. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
So we have been doing this tour for almost a year now, which is amazing. I don't think I would have, you know, done this with anybody else, or at least came up with the idea. And I have learned so much from Josh from doing this, and hopefully vice versa. I think for me, well, the Black Excellence Tour was something that we both came up with during the conference, and we just decided that a lot of these spaces aren't welcoming to trans, queer, and gender non-conforming voices, especially when you are a person of color, specifically Black, and that how do we attain that space and have agency and know that our voices are very much also important, and that you know, we need to do this work, and also kind of building these bridges between each other, networking with the work that we both were doing separately. We just felt that it was very necessary for us to join forces and fight evil like the true superheroes that we are. You know, we had the discussion of what that would look like, and how we can, you know, work together to actually make this work something that we can bring to other people, not something that we just talk about. So the Black Excellence Tour was formed, and yeah, we've been going to different cities just talking about the ways in which society affects us, and also making space to uplift the voices of the most marginalized and targeted in our communities. And it's been, you know, a part of us since then. Yeah.
And so we're really excited to be here today just to kind of have a space to talk about whatever issues are happening in the community, right? Like, we had a chance to have an informal conversation a little bit earlier on this evening about just the ways that the world around us can be a really scary place for people of color and for queer and trans and gender nonconforming people. And so a big part of, I guess, our job as like organizers, as an activist around these issues, is to kind of shed a light on them. In many ways, there's just kind of a lot of this oppression is allowed to happen because we're so isolated in the world that we live in, right? It's not important to get to know who the person is sitting beside you or who your neighbor is, and that makes it so much easier to displace people, so much easier for violence to happen and for there to be no accountability around it. And so really this evening, I'm excited to be here to kind of just open up the door to have these conversations and then to have a greater dialogue. I think one of the things that both CeCe and I have learned this year is that no one is an expert at anything, right? Like, all of us are experts on our own experiences and our own lives and all of the things that we kind of do from day to day. And so I think it could be really great if we have a chance to kind of open it up for a larger community discussion for us to begin having this evening as well. And so CeCe shared more about the Black Excellence Tour, and then you'll be able to share more about, you know, who you are and what your work is, but maybe I should go first.
Sure.
All right, so my name is Joshua Allen, and I'm a community organizer and activist around issues and violence that queer, trans, and gender nonconforming people of color face in the United States and abroad. And so CeCe and I got connected a couple of years ago. We were actually talking about this earlier in the week. Our relationship kind of started off as just like more of a friendship. And then I think that like many oppressed people in the United States right now, we recognize that we needed to stick together and work to make the world a safer place for the both of us, right? There's so much injustice all around us, and it's kind of, like I was saying, that isolation that gets created between all of us, where you kind of don't want to look out for and protect each other. And I think one of the things that we kind of learned early on in our relationship is that in order to build any movement or to build any kind of sustainable practice of protection or love or care, you need to kind of look out for each other. And that's kind of what we started doing first. And then as we began to get to know each other and share our stories, and I got to learn about her time spent in a prison, right? Outside of what it's like to hear about that in a movie, but to learn that from my friend. And she got to learn about stories of me being a homeless LGBTQ young person in New York City, which is a story that so many people share in New York City and metropolitan cities and rural cities all across the country, right? And so we got a chance to get to know each other and speak more about our experiences. And then that's when we kind of decided that the Black Excellence Tour was an important project to start. It was because we really needed the space to talk about these things. And so I guess I'll share a little bit more about the organizing work that I guess I'm doing kind of in, and I'm based on the East Coast. And I guess I'll share a couple of stories, I guess, about kind of what brought me to that work in activism, and then kind of what that experience has been like, and I guess how it brought me here. And so I am 20 years old, so I'm kind of young. And I've been growing up at a time where we kind of understand the world is changing, right? Much like this moment of right now, we understand the world is changing, yeah? When like people like Donald Trump are getting elected and you see like Brexit happening overseas and it's like, okay, the world around us is really shifting, right? And so for me growing up, I've been experiencing that shift in really liberal terms, yeah? So I grew up watching President Obama get elected. I grew up watching the Supreme Court ruling on same-sex marriage recently, right? Different inclusive elements of society with people like Laverne Cox being trans superstars, yeah? So I kind of learned that the world around me was changing in a more positive way. Or that's kind of how I assumed it to be, right? Based on what the media showed me and what other institutions in the world around me kind of informed, right? And that I also was kind of growing up in a time of death, of imprisonment, where I could see people like Elon Nettles, who's from New York City, just like I'm New York City, right? Dying and there being no accountability about it, right? Like the person who killed her, nothing happens. The police don't really find it necessary to have a major investigation. There's no incentive. And I'm figuring out what happens when queer and trans and gender nonconforming people face violence. And so I kind of grew up at that, in the nexus of that kind of weird space where I experienced so much liberal change happening. The world is becoming a better place. But also kind of underneath that liberal surface, there's all of this death and violence and incarceration. And so that kind of brought me to organizing. I kind of recognized, and I always kind of dwelled on that quote from Alice Walker growing up, where she says, activism is the rent that I pay for living on this planet. And so I recognized that, you know, I live in this world, there are people who are around me who are being impacted by things, I need to speak up, I need to do something. And I began to get involved in the community and the struggles happening around me. And so after the death of Eric Garner in New York City in 2014, he was killed by the New York City police officers back in the fall of 2014, the early fall, and there was just no accountability. And then that kind of death was preceded by Mike Brown, and then after it came a host of other deaths in New York City and all across the country around me, right? And it was so pervasive and so scary, I decided to start doing something. And so I organized with Black Lives Matter organizers and did the best that I could do to make sure that LGBTQ stories were included in those narratives, right? So that we didn't only care about what happens when Black men are killed by the police, but what about people who are trans and incarcerated? What about people who experience violence that's both interpersonal and that comes from the hands of the state, right? And I really thought that that needed to be a kind of racial justice issue. And so I guess that kind of work that I've been doing has kind of informed where I am now, and that's what CeCe is talking about earlier in the genesis of the Black Excellence Tour. It's really about creating that space, like I said once again, but also in remembering that kind of the issues and the different factors of oppression that exist in our life today, they're not separate or disparate pieces, right? They're all interconnected, and I think we live in a stronger and safer and freer society when we recognize them as such. And so that's just a little bit more about me. Thank you for taking the time to listen. And I'll hand off to CeCe now.
That was amazing, yay. Yes, come on. and that's why I love doing this work so much, because like we really did like just start this work as being friends. And I think that's where the communication gets lost with a lot of this movement work. It's like more of a hierarchy than like a friendship with people. And so people place these labels on each other as boss or, you know, whatever, you know what I'm saying, worker or colleague, and like not more so trying to come from a place of like understanding each other's, you know, plights and our movements and like why it is so important for us to do this work. And like I think we recognize that, not even just having to sit there and being like, this is important work, you know what I'm saying? Like we can just listen to each other's stories and being like in my head saying like, oh yeah, that has affected me too, and like that's why I push so hard to do this work. Just knowing that somebody else is going through this struggle with you, and knowing that, you know, you want that to change, because who wants to see somebody that they love, you know, going through some type of pain or through some type of turmoil, and knowing that you yourself is also going through that, and like, you know, you both wanted to be right for each other. So like that's what the movement is about for me. It's just, again, uplifting each other, uplifting the voices of the people who are most marginalized, and knowing that, you know, this person isn't just doing this for recognition or, you know, for a pat on the back, because like I'm not doing this for a pat on the back. I'm doing it because my life is necessary to my existence, and that's so important. But yeah, I kind of started doing this work around the time that I got incarcerated. I know for a lot of people who come into those situations, it's easy to either lose faith entirely and become the toxicity in which you have, you know, internalized from your environments, which I could have, you know, and just really not, you know, gave a fuck about the movement or the people within it. But I recognize how much of what was happening to me have been happening and will continue to happen, and how many of the people that I love have been affected by that. And that's why I push so hard, because again, like, I don't want to see anybody have to go through that type of pain, and have to, you know, push so hard for just, you know, basic necessities of existence, which is, you know, your price of happiness, you know, fair health care, you know, not to be harassed or to have to deal with violence. And that's why I decided to educate myself and thank so many of you and so many other people within my community who supported me and pushed me and you know, gave me reading materials and zines and things that kind of opened my eyes to the world that I was living in. Because, you know, I grew up in a very closeted, sheltered family where, you know, everything was based around Christianity, and, you know, you couldn't have any type of idea of life outside of this ideology. And so me having this information really woke me up and just kind of pushed me to stop thinking about how I am the person that's affected by this, but how we all are affected by this. And that kind of motivated me to, you know, look into the work and, you know, just get more involved. And I actually started to write a blog from prison, and that's kind of where it started, talking about the things that I was seeing happening within that prison, or just, you know, the prison industrial complex in itself, to see what was happening outside in, you know, society, and also how, you know, the world in general was shaped and built off of, you know, white supremacy and these forms of institutionalized racism. And, you know, it was hard for me to learn about the prison while being in prison, but it just gave me a more complex experience when learning about this situation. And I think for a lot of people, they think that because they know about the PIC that, or they're educated about it, that they know what the experience is. And by me having both of those things, they kind of made me want to get people to understand exactly what was happening within those systems and why it was so important to do abolition work. And, you know, and Josh was one of the first people who I've seen talk about it and, you know, actually, you know, openly and, you know, just filteringly saying, like, prisons need to be abolished, and, like, how it's connected to all of these other things, and knowing that we both had a basis around talking about intersectionality, and how that is so important to thinking about this movement if you're gonna be a part of it. And, you know, then Jack, hi Jack, I didn't know you were gonna be here tonight. And then, you know, Jack and Laverne wanting to do Free CeCe was a way of me saying, aha, now I have an outlet, now I have a way to get this information out, right? Because this could have been the same type of cliche documentary about a trans woman, right? You know, the transition story and all of that. And, you know, me and Jack both understood that we wanted to go somewhere different with this, and I'm glad that she already had that in mind and that this wasn't something that was going to be, you know, a basic movie that, you know, will please everybody. I knew that this movie was going to get under people's skin. I knew that, you know what I'm saying? Because, you know, who wants to hear about a black trans woman saying fuck the world, right? They always tell us to be coy and studious and to be respectable, and that's the only way that your voice could be heard, especially if you are somebody that's trans or queer or gender non-conforming, and just having this unabashed, you know, attitude towards, you know, society and making it so that, you know, what I'm doing now will make a difference, right? And that was what was important. So I'm glad that we had, you know, this opportunity and just even doing the work outside of, you know, Free CeCe, the organizing work, you know, working with different organizations and having the chance to speak at different universities and events and doing this with somebody that, you know, has the same type of standpoint about this movement just made it even better. So I'm very glad that I'm and honored that I'm getting to do this work, and that we and all of us get to make the decision whether or not we want to, you know, continue carrying the torches that are, you know, that the people who have fought before us, you know, and that was a decision that I had to make. And at first I didn't want it, because it's scary, you know, doing this work, and literally, you know, asking people, like, you know, you have to be a risk taker. You have to be willing to, you know, be willing to take, you know, fire and brimstone, because, like, that's what's going to happen. Like, there's going to be so many different, you know, elements coming against you. And that's what I've been seeing for me. And, you know, I'm glad that I have somebody that's just as solid and you know, non-wavering, you know, because it's easy to give into the temptations of, you know, even these nonprofits and the fundraising and all of these things that still have stipulations and policies, and, like, you know, we are putting, you know, we are literally risking our you know, our existence on this, you know, sometimes not even having ways to pay our rent, right? Because, you know, this is the work that we do, and not giving in to, like, wanting to be a part of these orgs that are actually toxic and things like that. Thank you. And I'm just, you know, glad that we are doing this work and that I work with Jack and that we have this film and, you know, not feeding into this bull crap. Do not feed into this Donald Trump bull crap. It's all in our minds, because in realities, what he has done will not be any different from what any of our presidents have done, even Obama, you know, which he has deported the most people out of any presidency, right? And so, like, we can't continue to hold this rhetoric and be like, oh, Donald Trump is going to kill us, when it has been happening. We have been murdered in these streets for centuries, right? And that's what's important. And that's why it's important for this work to be done. Thank you.
I imagine we're gonna come up on time soon. Should we open up for questions now? That could be very nice. Do you have anything about questions or?
I mean, I just want people to be, you know, open, but also be considerate of what you're asking, you know. I know that people say that there's no such thing as a dumb question, but sometimes considering what you put out there might be important. but I am open. You can ask about the movie. You can ask about the work. If it's something that you feel like, you know, you need to say, now's the time. I mean, I openly encourage, like, we want this to be like a conversation, not just y'all staring at us and being like.
Can you give an example of what questions not to ask?
I don't know how to, you know, answer that one really. More so like things about my body, I guess. Like that's important. Again, please don't ask me about the election because I don't care. I honestly don't care. I woke up this morning unbothered. Like, oh, okay, it's another day. Like, so please don't ask me anything about the election because what I just said is how I actually feel. Like, you know, there's nothing that any president that has been in office that, you know, won't do any more damage than it has. I mean, I understand that was scary. You know, Bush saying that, you know, please do not elect this man would probably definitely put people in a mindset of being very scared, but definitely, you know, they're all just wackos. Yeah, that's all.
Oh my God, but also it's not just about questions being bad, it's also about questions being good. And I'm someone who, like, as a community organizer, I honestly do believe that when we open up and we connect with each other across the ideas that we're having in our heads and the experiences that we have, that's when we really create change in the world around us. So that would also be really awesome as well.
I have something to say. Yeah, thank you both for living your ministry and your truth, and I want to welcome you both to the Bay Area and the TL. This is it. This is where the stuff happens. This is ground zero. We're on the front lines here, grinding it out day in, day out, setting up polling places, setting up places to gather, places to stay safe, places to just communicate. You know, we're working social media. We're going the free angles on that. You know, it's a really important resource to our community. You know, despite what people say about the dangers of, you know, big data, big media, that sort of thing, like, we need something to keep us together, and a lot of the time, social media is that glue. So, I just want to say, you know, again, thank you both so much, and my question is, doing your work, living the truth, if you could say the one thing that's the most important that just lights your fire, what is it? What is it about living your truth? What is the one thing?
I guess for me, living my truth is, you know, key to my existence, right? Because for a lot of us, we don't get to live our truth, even as a trans woman who have, you know, kind of been pushed into this trap of misogyny and sexism and just shaming my body and my existence and having to be processed to believe in myself and that my body or that myself supposed to be a certain type of way to be respected in society. And I think for me, even challenging the binary, some, you know, for me, a seemingly cis, pass, and trans person, you know, I have to consider with, you know, like even for instance, like Josh, and so many of my queer, trans, gender non-conforming friends have to deal with, right? There was even an experience, something I never really had to experience as a trans person, but seeing it for myself. But during an event, my friend was followed into a bathroom by a security officer, and seeing how bothered and upset they were by that, and just knowing that we're in a constant state of, you know, of unrest and under attack, and just constantly feeling like there is no space for us to have agency. And so for me, when I wake up, you know, a part of my being awoke is saying that, you know, I can be killed at any given moment because I'm Black, because I'm trans, because I'm poor, because, you know, I live here, or whatever the case may be. And that's what my drive is. That's why I push so hard, because I don't want people to have to be affected by the things that I am affected by. And if a person had a big enough heart and was selfless enough to understand that, then, you know, we would be more progressive in, you know, in that fact that, you know, I don't know exactly, you know, your background or whatever the case is, but, you know, if I seen that you were a person who was dealing with, you know, homelessness, or if you were dealing with poverty, or if you were dealing with, you know, violence, like, how could I help you through that, right? But some people don't care about that, even people within our own communities. And that's why I push, because, you know, not too many people that have a platform have a radical standpoint in the movement. Very, you know, complacent, very liberal. And I'm a person that's actually somebody that's like, no, fuck that. An injustice is an injustice. I'm not gonna, you know, pretend that it's not there when I see it. And that's why I do the work that I do, because there aren't too many people that are sticking up for people, you know, who sag their pants or do heroin or does sex work, right? Because, you know, people are afraid of those terms and afraid of, you know, how that imagery reflects off of them. But everybody deserves respect. Everybody deserves agency, and everybody deserves the rights to happiness and to exist. And that's why I do this work, because there aren't too many people who are sticking up for the underdog. Thank you. Claire, I think you had a question.
Well, my question is, you know, in our work, we often are talking about violence and talking about how we can prevent violence. And, you know, I think year after year, we see, despite increased trans visibility, there's just more violence happening. And to your point that it's always been happening, what are some strategies that you guys have to share out with communities, say the Bay Area and beyond, to really start addressing the violence that's taking place or really shifting it?
Yes, I definitely understand where you're coming from. I also think that maybe a point that I would make is maybe there's not enough research done on it, or maybe it's not a commonly held understanding, but I think a lot of us assume or experience a link and a rise in trans visibility and with the rise in violence that trans people face, right? And so I think that's a super important point, and thank you for that. And I think that what I'd have to offer is that violence is a systemic and structural issue, right? It's not always interpersonal. So when we think about violence, it has to be a little bit deeper than just, I don't like you, this is why I'm committing violence. It has to incorporate the things that are going on in the world around us, right? So we have to think about class. We have to think about race. We have to think about gender and body size and ability, right? These are all important things to think about when we think about violence. And so one of the really simple and small ways that I think about is simply checking in with each other, right? There are so many times where I know that I could be walking home late at night and concerned for my safety, and if something happens to me, like, who's gonna do anything, right? Who knows where I am? What if I didn't have enough money to have a cell phone that worked and that was on, right? It's about keeping in contact with each other, knowing where you are, knowing where you'll be, knowing that you can get safely from point A to point B. Because for so many people, that's a privilege, right? To be able to get safely from one place to another. And so a very simple way that we can keep each other safe is by connecting with each other, making sure that we're safe and checking in on each other. And then I guess, and I know CeCe will have a lot of things to say, and I think a second, more structural way to kind of attack it is recognizing that it happens right in institutions. So for example, in the Bay Area, this is an issue as well, right? If we know prisons and for-profit prisons and detention centers are issues in our community, right? And these are spaces where violence is perpetuated. Anytime people are being taken from their homes and kept in cages, this is violence, yeah? So how do we address it? Let's make sure we tackle those structural issues as well. Let's make sure we pay attention to where we put our money. Make sure we take account the economic impact of it, right? Let's stop giving all of our money to Victoria's Secret and to Walmart and to Target. And let's figure out how we can move our money into places that can keep people like us safe. And so that's, I guess, the structural way it offers as well.
Just to kind of follow that, think about the ways in which you are utilizing your privilege in your spaces, because that's so important, because, you know, not acknowledging that could be a form of oppression, right? When we think about going into our workspaces, and how are you coming off to your employees if you are a boss, you know, or a manager, or how are you, utilizing your space to have space for those that necessarily wouldn't be in that space or welcoming in that space, right? And uplifting the voices of the people who are in those spaces, because that's also very important. I don't know, when we think of the violence, it's everywhere. And, you know, when you have a certain image, violence is something that you probably endure more than others. So, like, have those type of conversations with, you know, people in our communities and just saying, like, you know, we have, you know, for instance, if you live in a predominantly white neighborhood or suburb, like, have conversations with your neighbors about the POC people within your communities and saying, like, hey, let's not calling the police be our first option if we see somebody in our neighborhoods, right? And that's so important because, like, we also know that police also brings a big form of violence into communities, and how those situations tend to end up is with somebody being hurt or incarcerated or dead, you know, if not all. And so it's so important that we think about the ways in which we are utilizing our privileges and having these conversations and actually within ourselves challenging, you know, anti-blackness, anti-PLC, agency in accessibility, challenging financial and class type of privileges and how that's important too, because, you know, I have those conversations a lot with people about, you know, how something is more accessible to them because they have the funds or that, you know, they have the class or they have the look, you know. I've been working tooth and nails trying to find, like, just a regular 9-to-5 job, and, like, how hard for me that is with a criminal background, also being black and being trans, right? And, you know, how many people are actually hiring black, trans, queer, GNC people into their spaces and actually making sure that they have a livable, you know, income and, you know, not just talking about these issues, but actually trying to help solve them. Yeah. Yes.
I had a question for Joshua, actually. You're non-binary identified, right? I am as well. How do you cope with the world that is just so relentlessly binary? It's just always an insistence on, you know, with the pronouns or the salutations. People like us are just considered to be, you know, mentally ill, which some of us are, and there's no shame in that, but you know what I mean. It's just not being taken seriously. How do you cope with it?
I thank you so much, and thank you for being honest with your story. And I think what I would say, it sucks, right? It sucks. But I think the thing that I tell myself all the time is, like, I know and I firmly do believe that, like, we are gonna live in a better world one day. I do believe that, right? And I recognize that I'm living in a world right now that's not the safest place for queer or trans or gender nonconforming people, but I know that one day it's gonna be a better world, right? And so the way I think about it is, why not now? Like, why not today? Why don't we just start this shit right now? Because I'd rather not be oppressed if I know freedom is gonna come around anyway, right? And so what I do is I speak up, I say something, you know? If this doesn't feel comfortable, if this is a gendered apparatus, I'm going to say that this doesn't feel good. I'm going to say that we need to start having conversations about how more people can be included in spaces. And if you think that I'm irrational because of that, that means that you have a problem with gender, not me, right? And so that's kind of the place that I start from. And also recognizing that this is a project of unlearning, right? That gender is taught to us all throughout society. So prisons are gendered, schools are gendered, language is gendered, yeah? And so we're kind of, gender is imposed on all of us. And I can recognize that it's something that we all may unlearn or relearn over the course of time. But I do demand that there's respect around all of our genders, and that if someone has so much of a problem, right, that they should be the people who are necessarily focused on making sure that we get free from these gendered apparatuses, because they're the ones who are bothered by it. And so that's, I guess, what I would have to say. But it's an everyday struggle, a struggle that I see you in, and that I want to say that I believe that we're going to live in a better world one day.
Yes. In your organizing of Josh and CeCe, what would you say, just off the top of your head, is one of your biggest lessons learned or biggest takeaways you could give to other organizers?
This is some real ass shit for me, and I'm sure Josh can vouch. But just knowing that in certain spaces, I'm just not acknowledged, right? And that I have to constantly fight regardless of the fact, right? Because, you know, for instance, recently we both were a part of a demonstration out of St. Louis, right? And like, first off, the conference was very, very just trans and queer phobic, and like, you know, not really acknowledging that we were there in that space, and was a part of the movement, and you know, just dismissed around the whole part of like, you know, talking about, you know, Josh having this experience with this security officer at a after party that was run, you know, funded and run through the conference, you know, having to be a part of this, you know, conference, and then, you know, having people dismiss that we were there and that, you know, we had a voice too, and just having people look at me like I was crazy as I was talking, and just furthering validating that, you know, these people will never actually let me be a part of this movement because, you know, of whatever, you know, standpoint that they have, whether it be because that I'm black or that I'm trans or that, you know, I'm poor or that I have a radical standpoint. And so, you know, being a part of this, I learned that I have to, you know, have faith and trust in myself and, you know, and follow, you know, alongside the people who are really actually fighting tooth and nail in this movement, like Josh and so many other, you know, advocates and abolitionists who have a radical standpoint, and like Josh said, like, you know, trying to convince people like we can start this shit right now, like you say the word, I got the lighter and the kerosene, just give me the word, you know what I'm saying, and I will start, you know. But like, not too many people have that standpoint, and you know, it's just so funny even like looking at, you know, a lot of the reactions of people on social media because of this election, and like, you know, how funny it is to think that, you know, these people think that there would be it like this new form of violence, and it's like, well, it's been here, right? Like when we even think of slavery, which was established, you know, hundreds of years ago, like the torture and the pain and the policies and the tactics that were used to maim and torture and kill and to, you know, internalize and embed these forms of, you know, internalized racism and violence and like that. Like, why is any of this new to y'all, or why is it now that it's scary? Because it has always been there. And I think that's why I push so hard, because like, people continue to like live in this loop of like, you know, thinking that they're liberated, but not really not liberated. And, you know, like trying to get people to understand that you're not liberated, you know, because I mean, how did we even get to a point in society where we have two, you know, imbeciles running for presidency? Like that in itself was already like a result of where our society is, right? And like, it's not, why is any of this new to y'all? Because, you know, we had somebody that was openly saying it. I mean, it's been happening, right? We know that the war on drugs was established in the 1990s, right? What happened in between then and now that people are just now all of a sudden scared? Like, oh my gosh, like a million more people in prisons. Like, why is that so scary now? You know what I'm saying? So, I don't know. I think that's, you know, why I push so hard.
And that's your organizing lesson learned.
Yes. Wait. What was the question to begin with? Because I forgot. I just started ranting. What was we talking about?
They were asking, like, what was the one takeaway organizing lesson that you've learned through your organizing?
Oh, that you just have to fight anyways. You know, like, because if you feel like your existence is important, if you feel like, you know, and I think that's why I, even in myself, was just like, you know, in prison, even before then, like, all of my life, I've been a person that recognized that was hella, you know, femme and hella not the person that people wanted me to be. And so I I had a non-give fuck attitude, right? You know, people told me all my life, oh, you're going to go to hell because, you know, that was this Christian value. And then I was like, instead of them instilling that fear in me and saying like, oh, let me get better, I was just like, oh, wait, you know, like, fuck it. Like, let me just do whatever I want then, right? And that kind of gave me the basis of just like having this attitude of just saying like, whatever, just do it, because like, nobody else is going to do it. Nobody else is going to care about your existence. No one else is going to really, you know, fight as hard as you for your own existence. So, you know, I think that's, you know, my big thing is like, you have to do it, you know, and just continue to do it, you know, because no one else is going to do it.
I think for me, what I've kind of been learning, I think that organizing can be really scary sometimes, right? And that we kind of build lofty ideas around it. So you kind of think, I'm going to go out and vote because I want to make a change in the world around me, right? That's like one way we think about things. So it's an action, but you also build around it, you know, kind of impacts that you're going to expect. And I think that one of the, I think the biggest life lesson learned through organizing for me is that it's not about, you know, it's not about a destination. Organizing and activism is never supposed to be about a destination or a point that you want to reach. It's about that journey, right? It's about the moments that we live from day to day, the everyday human interactions that we have, the precious minutes that we're living right now. Those are the moments, right, that you're supposed to be working the hardest in. Those are the moments that you're supposed to be dreaming about, right? Not the moments in the future. You have to do it now. I think that's what I've learned about organizing with them.
Hi, y'all. First of all, thank you so much for the blessing of your presence and your teaching. So my question was just that oftentimes in organizing work, a lot of people organize around big events in the community. So whether that was like what happened last night, or around an action of police violence or murder or something like that. And a lot of times the events that we're organizing around are also events where a lot of people feel the need or actually have to mourn and like take time to take care of themselves because it was a direct attack on them. And so how to either, my question is either for y'all from a personal standpoint or from an organizing standpoint, how do y'all balance that need to like care for yourself and mourn as a community while also taking moments of high visibility and high pressure that can lead to good action and taking advantage of those to further
I don't know, it's definitely been weird. And like even when Josh was talking about like growing up and being a part of that change that was happening, like I grew up in like the 90s, right, where there wasn't any change, right? And I was seeing this, like there was, you know, I'm even surprised that even within those 10 years, those, you know, 20 years, that there has been this like enormous growth and visibility of other identities and sexualities. But, you know, again, with that, you know, I've seen the violence, right? Like I've known people who were murdered in the streets. I've known trans women who were killed or went missing, and you know, like to this day, you know, and like that was a part of my life, you know what I'm saying? But because it was so condensed to each area that it wasn't like accessible for other people to see, right? And then we come into this age of, you know, the smartphone and the camera and like seeing each other struggle, you know, and being a part of that. I tell people all the time, like, if I grew up in an era, you know, if there was, you know, Facebook and, you know, in 1998, you know how different the world would be now, you know what I'm saying? Because of, you know, having that accessibility, maybe our movements would have been stronger because it would have started earlier. But we have to acknowledge, again, and that's why I don't want to keep reiterating this, but like, because Trump comes into office doesn't mean that these issues haven't already been here. You know what I'm saying? Slavery has been here and never has been de-established, right? Racism has been here and never once has been challenged or de-established in any type of way. So why is it so shocking, right? And so like all of my life I had to mourn, right? Every day that I wake up, I know that my existence is constantly being challenged and the people around me and how how I'm so fearful for the people that I love, because why? Like, we are the ones that are constantly being targeted. We are the ones that are constantly having to deal with the violence and the struggle, and people don't understand that. And so, like, yes, I make room for there to be mourning, but at this point at where I am, I'm tired of crying, right? I'm tired of just sitting back and just feeling like, oh, let's say the names of the people that have been murdered, and then after that, just go back to our normal lives. Like, how do you do that, right? So, like, for me, like, I make space for there to be mourning, you know what I'm saying, and to be sad, right? Even when I see, you know, police violence and the murders of, like, black men everywhere and black women, you know, both trans and cis, that, like, this is so important, right, that this work needs to be done. So with there being this space for mourning and to understand that this is happening, I've been understanding that this has been happening. It's just that for so many people now who have been in denial or who have been closed off to this information, like, it's saddening to them. But for so many of us who, like, have been done crying, like, we have been like, girl, like, shut up, like, we been there, you know what I'm saying? Like, this has been happening to us. Like, we're at that point where there is no more room for crying, that, you know, we have to push harder, right? And that's so important, because, like, don't feel the fear of what's happening now, that it hasn't already been happening. And that's so important. Really, it can somewhat be offensive at times for me, right? Because, like, everybody, and even when I see on social media and, like, people saying, oh, like, you know, for instance, like, oh, now I'm finna move to Canada. What about the millions of Americans who can't move anywhere, right? So, like, let's change this rhetoric and, like, really think about that, because, like, you know, I can't have place in my life to be, like, sad and depressed when I'm already dealing with depression and I'm dealing with mental health and I'm dealing with my environments and I'm dealing with family and loved ones and work and this movement. Like, there is no room for mourning for me. It just makes me angry to constantly have to keep seeing this and keep having to have conversations about mourning and not actually changing what is actually causing this harm and violence and pain.
I just think that I would say, and I know that we're gonna come to time soon, but I just think that I think that in many ways organizing is, like, just really the practice of righting the wrongs that exist in the world around us. And so I try not to even create that dichotomy between acting in moments of distress, right, and acting in, you know, down times. You know, like CeCe's saying, I try not to create a boundary between the two, because they do kind of exist on top of each other, right? Things in the world don't exist in a vacuum. They're all happening at one time. And so I think it's important to kind of recognize that we should be able to hold both. We should be able to hold, for some people, that the end of the world, that the biggest crisis is happening right now, whilst for some of us it could be a downtime or a time where we have more flexibility in our lives to organize around the things that are happening to us. So that's kind of how I try to think about it. And also to give it that same kind of diligence, the same kind of love, the same kind of intentional care about creating real sustainable change, I try to give it that same, you know, that same energy in moments of duress. And I mean that seriously, and I hope CeCe can attest to that. I've been in moments of extreme duress. I was on the streets after the day after Eric Garner, the day after Trayvon Martin, the day after Mike Brown, Trans Liberation Tuesday in New York, mobilizing hundreds of people to speak out against the murders that trans and gender nonconforming people face, right? I've been in those moments of duress, but as an organizer, I try to honestly give the same amount of passion in those moments as I would that I'm sitting in a room telling a story tonight, because I think that abolition and creating true change deserves that kind of passion every time.
Mm-hmm. So I think we're out of time. I'm going to give the mic back to Aria, right? And again, we want to thank y'all for coming in and sitting in. Our workshops are usually a little bit more interactive because with the time squeeze, we couldn't really get people to interact the way that we really want to, because it's really fun. But thank y'all again for this and for being a part of this. I hope I see a lot of y'all tomorrow for the screening of the film. And I don't know where it's gonna be. Oh yeah, the Roxy. Okay, so maybe Aria could tell y'all more about that when she get back on the mic. So thank y'all again. We love y'all. Thank y'all.
Yeah.
Can we give them a big round of applause? Like a really, really big one. Before we close out, I'm actually going to ask Danny and Fresh. Oh, okay. Well, Fresh. So fresh and so clean, clean to come up.
We have gifts for you too.
Oh. Thank you.
Thank you. This is for you. And if you don't mind, I want to read what's in there to share with the audience.
Oh my God.
Yes.
Hi everyone, I'm part of the trans employment team at the LGBT Center, just so you know. They just didn't find me in the back of the room. So this bottle was generously designed by someone whose name I don't know, actually. Together we rise as one. We are transgender, and a very generous donor had these bottles created just with these labels for you too. So. Hope you appreciate it.
So again, make sure to catch the San Francisco premiere of Free CeCe as part of the SF Trans Film Festival. It is going to be shown, if I'm using the right word, showcased, there we go, at 7 p.m. at the Roxy Theater, which is on 16th in Valencia, tomorrow night. So be sure to get there. And also, if you need more information about the Trans Film Festival overall, it is... So just Google Trans Film Festival San Francisco, and it should come up. We want to thank you all so much for coming out tonight to support the Black Excellence Tour with Joshua Allen and CeCe McDonald. What an inspirational evening. We hope we'll continue to do the work and hopefully we'll see some of your faces at the San Francisco Transgender Day of Remembrance on November 20th to commemorate the lives of fallen trans and gender nonconforming people, both domestically and internationally, and throughout the month. Downstairs there will be a mixer as well as a chance for you to mingle with everyone in the room, including Joshua and CeCe. So come downstairs for food and drinks. What kind of drinks? Non-alcoholic drinks. When they asked me to come, I kind of was excited, like, free wine. I'm just gonna bother these two for the wine. Thank you.
Also, please check out more of our work on our Facebook page, our Twitter, at BXT, right? I don't think y'all can see that down there, but you can, if you want to reach out to us, we have the Black Excellence Collective page on Facebook. Our email is blackexcellencetour@gmail.com if you want to reach out to us or if you're interested in doing work with us. And yes, please, if you got the coin, please donate, because like we're really trying to do some amazing work in our communities, and it's important for us to do this work. But you know, we are literally working off of a budget of like 5 pennies in a lollipop. So please, if you can donate and or if you want to be a part of the work, please just reach out to us, and it's important for us to do this work. So thank you.